takes a lot. I mean, it's difficult when you first start out, I think, especially with us, because it was so intense. It went from like never touring to just touring full on. Mm-hmm. So it was hard, you know, the first couple of months. It was weird for me as well, because for me it came at such a, like, yeah. my life was so crazy. Like it went from nothing happening for like 10 years, and then in January, my grandmother died, my parents got divorced, we sold our house, and I went on tour. So it was like, whoa. So I left home and I literally was like, I have nothing to go back to. Like, I thought I didn't have a house and my parents would split up. I was like, where am I gonna go? But with that, I kind of embraced it, and I got excited about it, and I became very much, you know, like Jack Kerouac, like, mm-hmm. on the road. And it was and now, God, we've been on the road for 15 months, and we've got another year to go, so it'll be 2 and a bit years of touring. But I love it now. It does become your reality. I'm a lot more comfortable being in a different city every day. If I wake up in the same city, I feel a bit strange. It sounds really hard. It's hard for me to be objective about it, but it was my plan. It was my plan. It was very difficult. I don't know what it is. There's loads of different reasons, isn't there? If we want to be, I could be very pretentious about it and say, there's no reason, it's just us. It could be down to the fact that there is lots of bands around, but there's not a lot of bands that are just four boys with guitars, because that's very easy to understand, the classic rock band, but we don't sound like four boys with guitars, you know. And I think that an interesting musical approach and a very, very classic lineup makes a lot of sense. Maybe that's to do with it. Maybe, I don't know, maybe it's because basically we didn't get signed. No one would sign us. No one would sign the 1975, not one major label. So me and my manager, who's like the fifth member of our band, we said, right, let's just do it like it was our favorite band. How would our new favorite band come around? We decided that we'd been doing it for too long to kind of put ourselves out there that much. So we were like, well, let's just be very careful about it. Let's put lots of music out, but not lots of photos, don't like do loads of Twitter, don't you just put music out and let people embrace it. And I think that before we even put out an album, we put out 4 EPs that had 16 songs on it, you know. We wanted people to really have a wealth of material to really kind of invest in. And that was our plan. We said, we'll release one EP and it'll get attention at radio, I think, because we had the connections. And we said, and I know if this song goes, then people will like this song. And then this song was Sex. And then once we've got Sex, then we know we've got Chocolate. It was all just a plan. I knew what, I hoped for the best. And everything was, with every step, was bigger than everything we ever imagined. And I've been a bit nervous about saying that. You know, people, the industry don't like the idea of, why did it happen? Because I wanted it to. But that's kind of how it happened. And you're a liar. But it's interesting with me because there's loads of interesting factors. My parents are famous in the UK. Mm. So I grew up around fame. I understood what it meant, what it did to people, the things about it that were important, the things about it that aren't important at all. I think I was quite well educated in fame before I became famous. You know what I mean?
Yeah, sure.
And I think that it's very, very delicate. The problem that there is with fame is the fact that the idea of fame nowadays is something that people desire. They want to be famous. Yeah. Like, what for? I don't care. I just want to be famous. And I think that a lot of people who are in bands aren't like that, but they get caught up in that. They think, God, in order for my band to be accepted, I need to be famous. That's not true. Well, maybe it is, but I never thought about it like that. I kind of almost avoided being famous. You know, we're a very, very glamorous band, and we look the way that we do, and the way that we look is a very big part of the band. But in the early days, there was like no photos of us or anything, because we just wanted to be about the music, and it kind of still is. With this year, I've gained a lot, you know, I've gained a lot, but I've lost a lot. I've lost the fact that, I think the hardest thing for us is that writing music for us just used to be like a diary. Mm-hmm. It just used to be the four of us. It used to be heard by the four of us, a couple of our friends. It would maybe get heard by a couple of record labels. It wasn't objectified. It wasn't exposed. It wasn't out there to be criticized. So it was very, very free. Now, every single piece of music, every single word that I say is up for criticism. That makes you feel slightly nervous. But I'm very, very conscious of saying that, but I don't care. Because I find that a lot of people say, oh, I don't care, when they can't think of something to say, or when they don't really know how they feel about something. When our album went to number one, I thought, oh, I don't care anymore. Because it proved that nothing is ever going to change. I spent the whole year of last year caring about everything. Caring about everything that was said about me, all of these kind of things. And then when the album came out and it went to number one, nothing changed within me. Nothing happened. And I was depressed. I was like, why has the... I've spent my whole life with the list of things that you do, you know? And in a year, we supported the Rolling Stones, we toured the world, this, and it was a number one album. And instead of, I was very, very proud, very, very flattered of it, and I don't want to sound like a pop star who resents it at all. But what I realised is the only thing that makes me happy and the only thing I care about is music as a model, as music, not its cultural relevance or what it means to this person or what, I don't know, David Bowie record was more relevant to whatever, blah, blah, blah. It's the pursuit of making music in the same way of eating, the same way of taking drugs. It really, really affects me, and it's the most thing that affects me the most. And that's all I care about. It really is. Obviously, I care about other things. But when we're talking about like the basic things of how I feel about things, the only thing that I really, really care about for me is just making records. Yeah. So all of your friends are, so am I. It would have been pointless putting pressure on ourselves because it was done, you know, like we'd finished that album a long time before it was even getting marketed. We didn't need it to go to number one to be more proud of it. We were so proud of that record. We still are proud of that record. And yeah, I think it did put a bit of pressure on us, and I went a bit crazy because I just wanted the album to be out there. And everyone was like, it's going to go to number one, it's going to go to number one, and it's going to beat Nine Inch Nails. And I was like, well, I don't want it to be a competition. I especially don't want it to be a competition against Nine Inch Nails, who are my favourite band. Yeah, you know, you just realise that there's people that are in it for one reason, there's people that are in it for the other reason. And when me and George were sat there in an office, there's a million people running around, and they've all got this paper and that paper. We just thought, it's funny, isn't it? we didn't really care.
And does it have any influence now on the way you handle things, like on the way you work now? Or how is it different from like before?
I think so. I think it does. This is very difficult for me to be objective. Yeah. You know, all I've done now for a year is had a year which was just surreal situations strung together by me talking to people about those surreal situations. I've not had any time for retrospect to realise whether I am a slightly different person. I think I might be. No, I'm definitely a different person to when I started out. I don't know. You know, I've never been very good at staying still anyway. Like, me and George write everything, and the way it works is we'll finish something and then I'll get it to where I think it's perfect, and then I'll be gone. I'll have forgotten about that piece of music for you, and George we'll constantly go through it. So when, even when we'd done the first album, by the week the first album had come out, I was already thinking about the second one. I was already working towards the second one. And that's all I do all day now, work on the next album that no one's even heard, that won't come out for another year and a half, but that's all I do.
And for this one, how do you feel the response to it was?
How do I feel the response to the last record was?
Yes.
It was amazing.
Yeah.
More than I could have ever expected, more than anyone could really ever expect. Especially because it's so personal.
Mm.
Like, we get, one of the things we're credited for is how relatable we are, how much people relate to us. And I just think that's amazing. And I think one of the reasons is because if you're so specific, like, every single thing on that album is a truth, is a story. The album's like a scrapbook of conversations and ideas and that kind of thing. And it's, when I think about those lyrics and those songs, the things that come into my head is my life. So when I see people connecting with it, it's odd. Because I think, you have no idea what I'm talking about. But then I think, well, maybe they do. Maybe they feel exactly the same. Maybe they've had this situation. Maybe they've had that. And when that happens in Paris or Hong Kong, or, you know, it's crazy. But it's amazing. And like I said, you know, everyone always wants to interview me now because they want to know what it's like. They want to know how I feel. I don't know how I feel about anything. I'm still trying to figure this all out. And I think that's what the first album was, me trying to figure stuff out. It's all it ever will be.
Yeah.
Yeah, counting cards is the best job you ever had. Cleaning up, it got you in its fours and its twos. You write pop music, and I think with pop music there needs to be a certain je ne sais quoi about the music, right? Whether it's the narrative, whether it's the lyrics or the music or something, if it doesn't take you somewhere immediately, then it'll be lost on you.
Yeah.
And that's our rule. If it makes you want to cry, if it makes you want to dance, or if it makes you want to laugh, then you hold on to it.
Yeah.
That's how it works. We're very excitable, you know? Writing music for us is us at our most excited. When I'm thinking about a song, I'm not thinking about... I wrote the video for Settle Down before I finished the song. So that's how I think about it. Everything is so cinematically based that I write with visual narratives, colours, that you should see our mood boards. That's why me and George can only work together, because George can't work with another producer, because we have our own language. There's certain colours that mean things, there's certain sounds and words that mean other things, and because we've been doing it for 10 years. I don't know what it is, but it's a very, for me, it's a very visual thing.
Mm-hmm.
I have to imagine the situation. I imagine the real situation. I amplify it. I make it slightly more romantic and more idealistic. And then I write about it. In the same way that you would do like a diary.
Yeah.
It was like a diary. Me figuring out aspects of my personality that I wasn't sure about or wasn't comfortable about through music. I think that's all it was. The idea of being inspired. I never need the inspiration to start writing music, because not lyrics and stuff, just music, sounds inspire me enough to get up and want to start creating. And then once a sound reminds me of something or makes me think of something or think of someone, I think, right, well, that's what the song's about. I try and do that. The first thing that I think about when I hear the song is normally what it's about. Yeah, it takes a bit more. Yeah, it takes a bit more than you. Well, yeah, I think the idea of a kind of synergy between visuals and music has always been very important to any big artist. If you look at, you know, Prince through to My Bloody Valentine to anybody, they've all got a certain amount of, they've got an iconic presence. I think that's where the whole box comes from and stuff like that. One of my favourite quotes ever was from Slash from Guns N' Roses, and he said, to be truly iconic, you need to be able to be recognised in silhouette. And if you think about Michael Jackson, if you think about Slash, if you think about all those kind of things. I've said this on numerous occasions. I think the obvious thing is that our music is very, very poppy, very, very colourful. and the imagery and the visuals are very dark and very black and white, and it's an immediate juxtaposition, isn't it? It's an obvious kind of duality between something really uplifting and something more dour. That's something that started off in the early days of being black and white, and we embraced more and more and more as the music got bigger, the images got smaller almost, you know what I mean? I think that it makes things quite clean, and I'm obsessed with imagery and the synergy between that and music, or the correlation between those kind of things. It's very important to me, and I think that, you know, this band is just an extension of my personality, of our personality, the way that I perceive things, the way that I want things to be perceived. And that's why there's a lot of kind of symbolism and that kind of thing, but I don't know where it comes from. I think that the easiest way for me to explain it is just an extension of who I am. I'm very much, I think that, like everybody, you know, I'm a dynamic person, I'm a multi-layered personality. Mm. So to try and kind of get that across, you have to cross things over. I'd kill myself for that music. Immediately. Life is pointless without music for me. Whether that's because I grew up in our generation. You know, our generation, we grew up with, you don't have to go too far back before images didn't even exist. Like, so we've got cinema. Like, our generation, a lot of people, the first time that you learn about, I don't know, a first kiss or that kind of thing is through cinema. It looks beautiful and it's soundtracked. That's very important. The idea that all of those moments you learn about early on, you learn through movies, they're soundtracked. I remember the first time I went to kiss a girl at about the age of 6. The first thing I was aware of was that there was no music playing. And I didn't like that. I did not like that. Music for me is, well, you know, I think you find it the kind of like a quantum analogy in physics, like the dark matter. The search of dark matter, that's what music is for me, because how amazing is it? I don't want to be a geek, but it doesn't exist. I'm only obsessed, my main obsessions are, well, women, I suppose. Well, I don't mean like that, but what I mean is, I've said a lot of time, I've always tried to find God in lots of different things, whether that's being drugs, women, etc., etc. But all of those things are tangible, and they exist, and you can see them, and you can feel them. Music doesn't exist physically, yet it commands every facet of my personality, and it has the power to command people how to feel. Imagery, words, they're very suggestive, whereas music can command somebody how to feel on an emotional level uncontrollably. I just find that so fascinating. So fascinating. The idea that it exists in another dimension, really. It makes me question everything. My love and knowledge and understanding of music has been the one thing that's made me sway more towards being religious. I'm not religious at all, but the more obsessed I become with music, the more I question spirituality and religion. And that sounds really pretentious, but that's true, because music as a form is just such a beautiful idea. And I'm obsessed with it, I'm totally obsessed with it. As far as I can tell, you are. I just want to be a bit happier. Mm-hmm. I want to be a bit truly happier. I'm constantly on the precipice of finding something that will make me truly happy. Problem is that I embrace that because I realise that search is what my music is made up of. So I become a bit of a parody of myself, of this kind of constant searching for happiness. But I want to, yeah, I don't know. I don't know, because the idea of evolution, isn't it? It's so small, and it's all about the minutiae, and I'd just be interested to see how I evolve, as opposed to having a vision of how I want to evolve. Mm-hmm. Be more interested to see it and explore that. But yeah. We're on tour until December. And then we'll start recording again.